Good afternoon, and this is Borderlob.tv. It's a Skinny Presents Wave Racer and Friends.
Yay!
Yo.
We have Wave Racer over here. Hey. We have Bowen over there.
Hi.
And we have his manager.
Yo.
You're now on an extensive European tour.
Yeah.
And this is your first time in London.
Yes, it is. This is my second day here.
And how excited are you?
I'm so excited. I've always wanted to come to London, so I'm super, super happy to be here.
So what have we done so far, though?
Not a huge amount. We got in yesterday afternoon, and we went straight to do a Just Jam set.
Okay.
The Just Jam boys, which was really cool. Played before Arl Grime and Slew Dem.
Slew Dem, yeah, the Grime crew.
Which was awesome. I had a great time. And then, yeah, went to sleep, woke up, came to Boiler Room. Here we are.
Amazing. Thank you for joining us.
Pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
So this is your second day in London, and you have a show here in London as well.
Yes, tomorrow night.
XOYO.
Yeah, XOYO, supporting Arl Grime.
So, out of all the shows you've done so far, where was he before this?
I've been going around Europe before this. So I started off, did a show in Poland, went to Barcelona. After that, I went to, what was after Barcelona? Amsterdam, which was amazing. Then Paris, and now we're here in London.
So you're hoping London will beat all of them all?
I'm expecting it to. No, I think it will.
I think the London crowd will appreciate royalty.
I hope so.
So what's been going on? Like, tell us a little bit.
How
did a bedroom producer go from this? Bedroom producer become this global phenomenon.
Global phenomenon. Yeah. I don't know if that's the right term, but I don't know. I started probably 14 months ago, making, I've produced music for longer than that. Like, I started producing music when I was about 18. I'm 22 now.
I didn't know. I thought it was older.
I am 22. And then Wave Race was kind of this project that I wasn't really taking that seriously. I just had some tunes that I had finished and I didn't even know if I was going to release them. I was just experimenting with new sounds that I'd never really worked with before, new tempos and stuff. And I just decided to put them up online. I had two original tracks that I made for free in my bedroom. And I put them up for free download on the internet, and then they kind of just got picked up, and I was lucky enough to get signed shortly after that, in a matter of months. And then a year later, I was touring.
Who did you sign to?
Fitch Classic.
Okay. Did you expect to blow up so fast, quickly?
Not at all. Still surprises me that I'm here in London, getting to fly around the world and do shows. It's insane.
Yeah. This is not your only tour. You've done at least three before this.
Yeah, I was in America early in the year doing a tour there, and I got two more visits to America coming up this year.
A full tour?
Yeah, I'm supporting Chromeo later in the year on their tour around America, and I'm doing a little festival kind of tour before that in August in America as well. And I've toured Australia several times throughout the year as well.
So how many times have you been home this year?
Not much. I've had maybe 8 to 10 weeks not touring this year or something, so a few months.
And how are you finding that? Do you think are you right with that, just not being at home? Or is it getting to you?
No, I like it. It's new. I've never done this before until this year. But I like it. I enjoy it. I'm lucky to be able to go around the world and play shows and just do music. It's
no regrets.
It's a dream. Yeah. No regrets.
So let's go back to you as a bedroom producer. But before Wave Racer, you were part of another crew called Pablo J and the Lobsterettes.
Lobsterettes. That's it, yeah.
Now, is that defunct or is that still alive? Or was that just on hold?
Yeah, it's hard to say. We haven't done anything for a while. That was me and a friend of mine who you might also know, who goes by the name Basenji now. I went to high school with him. I've known him since I was about 12. So he's really one of my closest friends. When we were about 18, we started this duo called Pablo J and the Lobsterettes. We made disco.
But where did Pablo J come from?
Out of nowhere, basically. We were getting into we were obsessed with French disco and Ed Banger Records and.
Okay, yeah, because it's very much of that kind of French.
Yeah, we were sound. Obsessed with French electro and stuff Justice, Daft Punk, Mr. Oizo, Breakbot, all that kind of stuff from Ed Banger Records in Paris, and we wanted to make stuff like that. So we were just sourcing, Seb Basenji is really good at finding samples, and he had a huge collection of disco albums which he'd downloaded online. We're talking 12,000 songs or something. And he would like spend hours every day just like scrolling through all the best samples, and like he'd send me the coolest ones, and I'd like build tracks out of them or build ideas out of them. And then we put out like, I don't know, maybe like 10 or 12 songs and a few remixes or something. And then by the time, like, we were doing gigs around Sydney, nothing serious, like just DJing around Sydney, and like it was it was just a bit of fun really. And then after a while of that, I started Wave Racer and like doing that whole thing, and then he started Basenji, and so we're each doing our own projects now, and they're doing better than Pablo J ever did. So,
oh, amazing.
So we haven't kind of gone back to Pablo J, but maybe one day we'll do something. I don't know.
This is actually a track by Basenji right now called Speak with a Dolphin.
Yeah, that's it.
So I'm gonna let this play, let you guys hear it for a bit. So I know you have something to say about Basenji.
Yeah, I was just saying, it's just kind of funny how Wave Racer started Pablo J and the Lobsterettes with Basenji. And now Wave Racer signed a Future Classic, and Basenji just got signed a Future Classic just a few months ago. So everything ended up just coming full circle, which is pretty crazy. So.
But who else is on Future Classic? I know there's Flume.
It's like Flume,
Chet Faker,
Jaguar Ma, CK,
Flight Facilities,
Touch Sensitive.
So it sounds like it's the label to be in, like,
yeah,
in Australia, right?
It's just the biggest thing right now. It's crazy. So
they're killing it.
Yeah. They're absolutely slaying it right now.
Who owns and controls Future Classics?
Nathan McClay, and Chad. Okay. So Nathan manages Flume and a bunch of other acts, and yeah, they've been running for Future Classic for nearly 10 years now. So
right, big up, 10 years in the game.
Yeah, it's
big
crazy.
Up Future Classics,
so,
man.
Yeah, big ups.
There's also another track that I really want to play before we run off. So many people don't really know about Pablo J and Lobsterettes. So I want to play one track from maybe the last EP that you put out.
Yeah. It was probably a year ago.
Did you try to keep that secret from the world? Or?
We didn't try to keep it a secret. We just didn't. We didn't really put much effort into publicizing it, because by that point, by the time. It was weird because we made those tracks a long, long time before they got released. By the time they came out, we had moved on to like other more important things.
I want people to know. I'm going to play a track called... Which one do you want to hear? Dance Till Dawn or Brenda? Which one do you want to hear? Dance Till Dawn or Brenda?
Brenda is my favorite.
Brenda is. I'm So moving on from Pablo J. I don't know, that name sounds so funny to me. I keep thinking of like some Hispanic guy.
Yeah.
Pablo J and the Lobsterettes.
That's
moving
it.
On from Pablo J and the Lobsterettes. You're saying you went one way, you went the other way to make Wave Racer. So how would you like, how would you describe your sound? Because...
That's a good question. It's, I get asked that a lot and I never really know how to answer. And I always say that I think other people do a better job of describing my sound than I do. Mm-hmm. So like I get a lot of really like good adjectives from people who like say what my music sounds like. So I don't know, a new like a hashtag that has emerged recently is neon, which I'm not sure if I 100% like I'm down with that, but like it's cool. Like it kind of does a good job of describing a certain element of the sound. But
like city light nights, Leon?
Yeah, I'm not, I don't know, man. Like, I didn't come up with it. Like I said, other people do a better job of it than I do. But yeah, I guess, like, it's basically just, like, I set out to just create music that makes me feel good and makes other people feel good. It's not really about trying to achieve a certain sound or fit into a scene or genre or anything. It's, like I said, like, I made it in my bedroom, just kind of vibing on whatever I was listening to at the time, which is usually just stuff that I found on SoundCloud scrolling through the internet. So it's just an amalgamation of lots of sounds from the internet all across the world, like everywhere. So
it's like similar. Well, you're sitting next to you is Bowen.
Yes.
You
shout out
Bowen.
Could
say it's similar vibes to kind of not really the same, but similar vibes to Wave Racer. What would you say?
I mean, I think we're coming from the same kind of perspective, as like kind of trying to take a like underground aesthetic in a really kind of hi-fi, kind of high quality way, kind of glossy, and not being too concerned with like a really authentic kind of sound that's really reverby or whatever, just being really kind of upfront with this kind of like pop approach, I think, is the general thing, which I mean, I think would lead to people to classing us and like other people as neon maybe.
So like 2014 kind of pop computer music. Like it's so hard to, maybe that's the greatest thing, not trying to define it.
Yeah.
But you know, people do want to define it, like want to write about it. And sometimes the producers get upset when the journalists write something that they don't want to hear. And so it's always best to ask, like, what do you call this music?
Yeah, but I think the common thing is like, a lot of these underground people want to make pop, and a lot of pop people want to get with these underground people. And I think that's kind of the main thing that's happening right now, maybe. Despite like whatever genres people kind of want, that seems to be kind of the approach that is sort of around now at the moment.
But it seems to be really thriving with the likes of like Ryan Hemsworth, Sophie, PC Music Crew, AG Cook, probably some more names. Well, you two, of course.
Like Lindsay Lohan, Matzo. Yeah.
Cashmere Cat.
Yeah, Lido. Of course. Yeah, Cashmere Cat, of course. And
Lido.
But he's even crossed over to like work with like big R&B stars like Ludacris and Wiz Khalifa.
Yeah, Cashmere's killing it. He's doing everything right now. It's awesome.
He's like, he's rooting number one. Everyone's coming through. And you're all friends though as well.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah.
How would you, do you have anything to add about the sound that's currently being out there right now?
I think like Bowen like described it the best way, like pretty much it's kind of underground music, but like the production is approached in quite a hi-fi way. Like it's just, the production's just so rich, but the, but yeah, I can't even describe it. I don't know what I'm talking about anymore.
I mean, it's hard, but it's good
to get
some other people's opinions.
There's never an answer really.
Have you ever been frustrated and just given like a really like angry answer, like is this, it's nah, fucking music?
Yeah, well, I don't know, like it, I get asked a lot, but I don't, my answer is just so boring because I just don't know how to answer it. So I always just kind of say that, exactly what I just said. But like I guess it's kind of a, what's it called, like a cheap answer, just to say like I don't really know, like it's not anything, because it isn't really, but it's like, it's a lot of things. It's more a lot of things than it is nothing. So like, it's more a combination of sounds than it is a new sound, I would say.
So I guess the thought process to like making a track would be like 10 million, like if you dissect your track, it would be like a lot of things in there to look at.
Yeah, there's a lot of layers. I think that's kind of an important thing, to have lots of different, well, for me anyway, to have a lot of layers and have a lot of stuff overlapping and like combining to create something new. That's
the kind of musical journey, sort of.
Yeah, that's part of my methodology, is to just like make something new out of existing things. So like I'll find like, you know, I'll combine like a footwork beat with like a pop chord progression or like a disco sample or something. Like,
so you do sample?
Yeah, I use samples here and there. I kind of play with them so much that they become a little bit unrecognizable. So it's hard to pick them always.
I think if anything new you put out has sample in it, I don't think I've ever realized that there is a sample in it.
Well, yeah, that's kind of the goal. Like I use samples more as like, it's like, you know, a painter would like use paint. It's like they're just samples. Like
oh, yeah,
that's all it is. Like it's just a material, like a building material to create something out of. It's not necessarily like, I don't use the sample to be recognized or to be like derivative or anything. I just use it as like a building block for my music. It's like an instrument kind of thing.
Would you say your music is best listened to on the bus or going for a run or like
anywhere, man? I think it's good in headphones. I like listening to, like, I think headphones is a good setting. Like it's good in the club too, but like listening like in headphones, you can hear all the detail, and like I think the detail is the most important part, like because there is so much detail in it, and like that's kind of what makes it fun, to be able to hear all the little tiny bits and pieces. So like a quiet setting where you can actually like hear everything and like soak it all up is good. I don't know anything specific, but eating ice cream is a good one though.
Yeah, I think like yeah, in summertime like this, eating ice cream and hearing some really amazing poppy.
Outdoors is good, like sunlight, like, you know, eating ice cream at the beach or something.
Would you
cool.
What is like your inspiration to like for making, say, the track with Ryan Hemsworth, Streamers?
Yeah.
What is the inspiration behind that?
Well, so that track was my like my original track. Ryan did a remix for it.
You remixed his, right?
Yeah, I remixed the track off his album, the track Ryan Must Be Destroyed, off his album Guilt Trips. And yeah, so basically the way that worked is I was working on a new single, and Ryan, like I'd met Ryan before I was working on this song, and he knew my old original tracks and heard my remixes and stuff, and he wanted to work with me in some way because he was a fan, and I've always been a fan of him as well. And so he hit me up. He was like, are you keen on doing a remix of my song? And I said, yeah, of course, I'd love to. And then we kind of just came up with this idea where he wanted to do like we thought it'd be cool to do a remix swap and like release them both together. So he sent me the stems for his track, which he wanted me to remix. And I just said, well, okay, I'm working on a new track right now. It's not finished yet, but when I finish it, would you be keen to remix it? And he was down for it. So I he hadn't even heard the song yet. And when I finished it, I sent it to him and he liked it. And he was like, yeah, I'll remix it. So he did it. And by that time I had finished my remix for him as well. So like, it just worked really well. And we had both these cool tracks, which were like completely new reinterpretations of each other's existing songs. They didn't really sound anything like the original ones, but it's still a remix because the original elements of each song are there. So that was a really cool project. I really enjoyed doing that. And I think the result was like really cool. So that remix I did for Ryan is probably one of my favorites.
Probably one of my favorites too.
Thank you.
But how long did it all take?
Not that long. It was actually pretty quick. The longest part was me finishing my track because I'm a really slow worker. Uh-huh. So like he had to wait for me to finish my song, which was probably frustrating. But that took like maybe a month. And then like after that, he did his remix in like 2 weeks or something. And I finished my remix for him in a couple of weeks as well. So didn't take that long at all, really.
Okay, touching on the subject of Ryan, I actually want to play the remix that he did for you.
Yeah.
If I can find it real quick. Awesome.
Pick up Ryan.
And you also, not recently, but you did a mix for Diplomat and Friends on BBC Radio 1.
Yeah, back in March. That
was pretty huge. This year, right?
Yeah.
It's pretty huge. Yeah, you excited about that?
Yeah, it was really exciting to do that one. I don't do that many mixes. I've only really done a few, and so...
Why is that, though?
I don't know. You've
been approached, or you just like...
No, I get asked a lot, but I don't like doing them that much, just because I do like doing them, but I don't like doing too many of them, because my approach with mixtapes is that I don't really like do them live. I kind of produce them, I just come from a producer mindset. Everything I do is like produced, so like basically to me a mixtape is like an hour long production, and it's like a lot of work.
And it has to be perfect.
Well, yeah, like I'm obsessive with that stuff, which is probably bad. But I play it, yeah, like it's good, but like the process of doing like an hour long mix was very like long for me, so like it took me a while to get it all the ideas, find all the right tracks, and like, you know, make sure I'm fitting all my own stuff in there in the right way, and like making sure everything is in key. And
no, of course, like, perfectionist has to be.
But like the end result is good, but like I can't do, if I spend too long doing all that like stuff, I wouldn't like it. I probably run out of ideas as well, so like if I do too many mixtapes, it's like it's just overboard, like, so I have to keep it safe, like do one or two a year.
Yeah, it's good. So like, just like me, it takes me probably like a week to do like a mix. Like people ask me to do a mix, I'm like, yeah, I can do it for you. Sometimes I delay it because it has to be really perfect, and the tunes have to be good, and
exactly.
It has to sound good, and
you want it to be good.
If you listen to it back and it sounds shit, I have to go back and redo it.
Especially one that's going to be on radio and like on the internet, like people are going to listen back. You don't want to have too many mistakes in there.
But what's up? You can't download it on your SoundCloud.
I put it up for one day and I took it down.
Why is that?
I did that with my last mixtape as well, just because a lot of the stuff in there is some of the stuff in the mixtape is also in my live show.
Uh-huh.
So when people see me live, I want it to be fresh. I don't want to spoil it too much.
The experience.
The mixtapes are out there. Like people have downloaded it like thousands of times. So if you want to find it, like it's there. If it's on my SoundCloud, like it's just there, public viewing. And I don't want people to get too saturated by my mixes. I more want them to listen to my songs and get to know my songs and then come and see me live, and then they can experience like the live show, which is kind of like a mix, but more like it's different when I play it live. So
I get you.
Yeah.
So
like,
have you?
I keep it up temporarily as like a little gift, and then I take it away.
Have you? That's a nice concept.
Yeah.
Have you ever met the man Diplo himself?
Yeah, I've met him a couple times, I think. Yeah. Not very briefly. He's always very busy, so I don't. Can't,
yeah,
like,
of course. He's
can't nail
the
him
clock,
down.
Man.
Yeah.
Everywhere.
Yeah.
But it's also kind of a slight relation between you and Diplo. You have, if I'm correct, a new song coming out on his label.
Well, yeah, it's not strictly my song. It's a song that I worked on. Yeah.
Okay, who do you work on with it?
Liz.
Secret? Okay, cool. Yeah. Liz on Mad Decent as well?
Yes, Liz the singer who signed to Mad Decent Records, yeah.
Can we hear this song?
I can show you a snippet.
Yeah?
I can't show you the... I don't know if I can show you the whole thing, but I can give you a little tease.
Yeah, give a little taste.
All right, I just got it. It's on my laptop, so cool. Go set it up.
I lost you, so I guess I'm not your treasure no more. Your little dime piece, all that I need, that just went out the door. Now you're thirsty for some love, and when you gave up the source, you're gonna want me back. I did something I love. What you gonna do when you see me booed up with another dude? You're gonna wish you would've had this bag, this, 'cause I'm the motherfucking baddest, baddest. Got me sitting up top of this food chain, running this block, running the chain gang. Like a kind of creature that'll beat your body, wake up in the morning, feeling like a
clap, but I'll give you a clap on my yeah, thanks guys. So thank you for chatting with me. Basically
my pleasure, thanks for having me.
Took a time out of your busy schedules to stay here with me, and I appreciate that.
Thank you.
And I want you now to go and do your thing, basically.
Sure, let's do it.
Up to you. Bolon.tv, Skinny Presents, Wave Racer and Friends, live in the boiler room.
We back, and we back, and we back, and we back.
like it ain't nothing. Black dog, honey in the backyard. Shawty got the black ball showing off. Let it up, hands turning up. She a bad bitch and she already know it. Yeah, she know it. Yeah, she know it. Yeah, she know it. Yeah, she a bad bitch and she already know it. Yeah, she know it. Yeah, she know it. Yeah, she know it. Yeah, she know it. She gon' make me spend some money on it. Yeah, she know it. Old bank account, I blow it. Go do a show to you. Samoan. Pockets bigger than the Samoan. We make the stage every time. Shot it go in. Shot it go in. Shot it go in. Beat the throat in. Slow motion. I'm so gone on patrol. You know I'm getting home later on. Like, clean, ignore, ignore, ignore.
You got a drink?
Thank you.
We'll be right back. slim nigga sticking your cheek, pulling tricks, looking slick at all times when I'm flipping, bar sipping, car dipping, grand wood grain gripping, steel tipping, on steel tipping, now steel rapping, steel rapping, steel pimping, steel hoping, and no hacking, and no hacking, steel blowing on that endo, GameCube, Nintendo, 5% tint, so you can't see up in my window. These niggas don't understand me, cause I'm boss hog on candy, top down at Max's with a big Glock 9 handy. Up, creased up, stand dressed to impress. Big boss belt buckle under my Mitchell and S. Oh, Gucci shades up on my braids when I escalate. When I'm riding spree wheel, sliding like an escapade. I got it made, the big boss of the north. Ain't shit changed, I still represent what's your house.
God damn. Ah, well, that was great. Thank you for joining me here today, again on such short notice and taking the time out of your busy schedule to be here, me at ballroom.tv. I hope you enjoyed yourself. It was good. Thank you guys for joining me here in the studio. Ballroom.tv, this is Skinny Presents, over and out.